And he heard me, and he delivered me. Okay. Verse 21. The Lord rewarded me according to what?
My
righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands, he repaid me. For I have kept the ways, that's the key, I've kept the ways of the Lord, and have not wickedly departed from my God. All his judgments were before me, and as for his statutes, I did not depart from him. How did that relate to us? I knew his word, I kept his word. I knew what he wanted, I kept doing it. And then when something happened, Psalms 51, Lord have mercy on me. And he says, it's the fool who says there is no God. So he realized he had a God, and he was supposed to live up to his expectations. When he failed, man, I messed up. God have mercy on me. Hallelujah. Okay, then we're going to verse 29. For thou art my lamp, O God, O Lord, and the Lord will enlighten my darkness. For by thee I have run through a troop. By my God have I leaped over a wall. As for God, his way is what?
Perfect.
The word of the Lord is tried. Buckler to all them that do what? Trust in him. That's the key.
Trust.
He'll keep you if you trust him. Because the yogurt and the stuff is going to come up and going to be all over you. All right, brother. Life has a way of dealing you a hand. How are you going to deal with it? For who is God, save the Lord, verse 32. And who is a rock, save our God. God is my strength, my power. He maketh my way perfect. Make my feet like hinds' feet. Set me on my high places. So this is what David is saying. In distress, when he's going through something, I'm gonna call on God because he's gonna deliver me. He's answered me before. I'm gonna call on him. So this is that's the first thing that David says, the anointed God of the one of Jacob, the sweet psalmist, the one who knew how to praise and give thanks to God. Okay, now back to our lesson, verse 2. The Spirit of the Lord. To be a leader, to be a Christian disciple, to be effective. Here it is. The Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his words was in my what?
Tongue.
Your neighbor, your family get tired of you quoting, saying the word, or just say, that's okay, y'all are fools. Because here's my deliverance. Right here. He know his deliverance is in that word, that anointed word of God. He keeps speaking. When you speak it, it's the rhema. That rhema. Keep bringing it out. Then let it be the logos, right? David wrote the song. He wrote it. When he wasn't expressing it through his tongue, he was pinning it on paper. And he was coming through victorious. Okay. Now we're going to jump to the God of Israel said, the Rock of Israel spake by me. Now, so he knows that the Word of God is like a rock. Can you change a rock? Whatever it comes out to be, that's what it is. When it solidifies and becomes that solid piece, that's it. You can't change it. So this is what he said about God's word. It's steady. It's right there. It's a rock. And you got that. So the word, the Rock of Israel, spake by me. So he put God's word in his mouth that he ruleth over man. He that ruleth over man, he that's going to be a leader, must be what?
Yes.
Ruling in the fear of God. Can we say that about our leaders today? Do we really think they're doing that? They really fear that if they make the wrong move, it would dishonor God. Mm-hmm. They bring about the wrong policy regarding the poor. Mm-hmm. It would dishonor God. They got this Medicaid thing expansion in Oklahoma, and we don't know what we want that. We don't know we want that. We got some federal money coming in for you to help your poor people out when they get sick. We don't know we want that.
Another debate.
telling us all in the Psalms how to get successful with God. Consider the poor. Look at this, Isaiah 11:3. This is the man that will fear God. This is what God would do for him. So I'm reading. Isaiah 11:3.
And shall make him of quick understanding to fear the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ear.
Verse 4.
But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked.
That's right. So, there's a standard. We had the judges last week, the judge, and then you got the king dealing with the affairs of civil affairs. There's a standard that you set your policies of your position by. What's the standard? The word of God. I don't care about the enough justice. South Indiana homeless. Poorest counties in the state. We don't want them. That's messing with y'all. I know about Democrats. But y'all Republicans. Gotta go. Alright, verse 4. Now he should be as the light of the morning, the leader, because he has a standard that he's moving by, that he's operating by, and his wisdom, his results, whatever, is going to be like the light of the morning. How many of you get up early in the morning and see the sunrise? Feel the freshness of the day. Before you get up, like I say, you get up at 3 or 4 o'clock this morning, go outside before the sun now starts baking away everything that was fresh. That's how a man of God is with his wisdom and his judgment. It's like freshness coming in. When the sun rises, even a morning without clouds, as the tender grass spring up out of the earth. See, every morning they got this dew. And, you know, and fresh grass will come up. Before people get out there and walk on it and trample it, and before the day messes it up. That's how the results are, the wisdom of a man led by God. It's just such a fresh, refreshing deal. Out of the earth, by clear shining after rain. In other words, freshness. Now, let's go to verse 5, if you will, please.
I don't mind. Although my house be not so with God, yet he hath made me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and sure. And this is all my salvation and all my desires, although he made it not to grow.
Okay, here's what he said. Although I'm not perfect, God called me. Mm-hmm. He says, I'm a blessed man. I'm just blessed. Although my house be not with God. In other words, everything about my life is not perfect with God. Uh-oh. Oh, you can't go to Northside, listen. Everything about my life is not perfect with God. He says, you wouldn't come to my house, my life, my history, find heaven. Why would God make a covenant with a man like that? I bet that poses Christian. Why would God call somebody like Saul of Tarsus? Wow.
Well, how great he is.
David said, my house is not all there, right? But he made a promise to me. Mm-hmm. Oh.
We can speculate.
Mr. Samuel 7, maybe. What do you say, sister? Sister Yvonne, I thought you had something on your mind.
Okay, but the man that...
No,
oh,
I thought you had something on your mind.
I did. Yeah. I said, because he can take something from nothing, he can make it great. That was my thought. And whoever he choose, if he chose you, you're going to be great in his eyesight.
When it comes to choosing, go ahead, Sister.
I was thinking along the same lines that when it comes to choosing, sometimes God will choose the things to confound the wise, mm-hmm. that we would look at our person and say, oh, no, mm-hmm. no, not mm-hmm. that person. But he can take that person and make them and mold them, and he sees the heart mm-hmm. of that person. Mm-hmm. And we don't always see that, so he sees what they can become. And that's what he saw in us when he died. He saw what mm-hmm. we could become, you know. And the outward appearance doesn't always, you know, meet the standard. But we don't know what the heart, you know.
God has chosen the base things of the world.
Right.
To confuse those out.
That are wise. That think they are wise.
Yes, that think they're wise. He'll just pick something and just say, he can't work with that. He can't get that to be.
They're so unpromising.
He chooses the foolishness of the world. He says, wow. He can take a life that's all the way upside down and turn it right side up. How did that happen? God chose that person. God's working with that person. But you and I can't see.
Right.
Can't deal with. I know back in 78, I wouldn't have called Williams.
There's
that
a
Williams.
Williams, take us to the
We would have ever thought that with Paul's, when right. he was Saul, that he would call him. Yeah. I mean, he was the chief of sinners.
And that's question. God, now, this is the man that's killing everybody. You want me to go over there and lay him? Oh, look, you should. This guy.
Are you sending me to my dad? I ain't doing
it. And David's family was confounded. Him? Him. That's who. That's okay. Okay, so he chooses that person, that type of life, and he says, now I want to make a covenant with you. I'll make a deal with you. I promise you, God has said, I promise you, if you work with me and do what's expected of you and work, you'll be. Okay, you say so? Okay.
I think there's another reason too, Brother William.
Okay.
When when a person like that is chosen, mm-hmm. then when you're elevated, then you're in a position where you can understand other people that are like that, yeah. and where you can help to bring them up.
Okay.
And sometimes when a person has not gone through all of that, they may tend to look down or cannot understand or whatever. Let's just make it like that.
Okay. I think I'm trying to find 1 Samuel 13 and 4.
1 Samuel what?
13 and 4. Now, why did David have to replace Saul?
Okay, because Saul was disobedient. He didn't
Saul wouldn't do what he's supposed to do.
No, he was disobedient. He was the first king.
Yeah.
But promising and all, but he was disobedient.
He got beside himself right away. Uh-huh. And David said, God. I want you to do what I called him to do. I don't have nothing for you. I can't be good. I've got nothing to do. I need a vessel.
And that's in the 13th verse of that same scripture.
Uh-huh.
And it's Samuel said to Saul, that's why, mm-hmm. thou hast done foolishness.
Mm-hmm.
Thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, mm-hmm. which he commanded thee.
Mm-hmm.
But now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever.
Forever.
Mm-hmm. But now, Thy kingdom shall not continue.
All right.
The Lord has sought him a man after his own heart.
All right.
And the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which he, which the Lord commanded thee.
That's right.
So,
you had opportunity, Saul. The Lord's going to find a man that's going to do what he wants to do.
I'm waiting on
you. You can't wake up, be born, and say, okay, I'm going to do whatever God, I got something, I know God wants me to do this. How do you know that? But not until God, what, choose you and call you, and you say, you know what, I know. I got it in me, it's something. That God called me, want me to do this. Otherwise, you just smoke on that. And then it says, how do you confirm that? His word. It's a rock. That's a solid rock.
So should he have wrote the Psalms?
Oh, Saul?
Was Saul supposed to write the Psalms?
I think David penned the Psalms out of his experience.
Okay.
And you're saying
Saul
have been the one who went through all the stuff David went through to write the Psalms experience.
I don't know that we know that.
Because if he called David to do what Saul was supposed to do, you would think
to bring glory to God.
Yeah. So
Saul
you would think
was he wouldn't keep his boys in order. Keep his house in order. Yeah. And a whole bunch of other stuff.
That's curious.
That's a good question.
But we do know that the Lord working with David made him a psalmist, a prophet, and a king, a warrior. Hey, this guy just went off the charts with God. How does a man get that successful? He's moving with God. And you don't know what the heights are. The heights are just out there. Okay. All right, let's go back to our lesson.
I think so.
Oh, did someone say so?
Yeah, I think the answer to his questions is in that 13th verse.
The 13th verse?
Or? Yeah, of the 13th chapter of First Samuel.
First Samuel? Okay.
Yeah, what he said, the one we just read, the last part of it said, okay, who's done for, he's not kept it. Which the Lord commanded thee, for now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever.
Yeah.
Would have established forever through him, through Saul. So I think that was perhaps the answer.
And those are things that Saul knew that the Lord wanted him to do. And maybe nobody else was in on it. Saul, turn right, go do this. Saul, straighten out your house and get them out of order, your boys. And get them in, and cut out all that crazy worship and all that Christmas trees. Saul just wouldn't live. He wouldn't come in. He wouldn't work with God so God could move the nation forward. Oh, boy. All right. So, verse 6 of our lesson. Someone read that. We'll see why Saul, on this next verse, can't go forward.
But the sons of Bela should be all of them as thorns thrust away, because they cannot be taken with hands.
Okay, but the thorns can't be handled. How many got a rose bush? Maybe accidentally.
Ooh.
Oh! Yeah. Can't do nothing with these people. They hurt you. Can't do nothing. Saul, I can't hang with you no more, man. You will have become, and that word Baal, translated worthless.
Worthless.
Oh, good.
Worthless.
Worthless. You have become worthless to me. No value. That's what happens to Saul. He become worthless. You're not going to bring glory to the kingdom. You're not going to honor God. You're not going to work with God, partner up with him, and let him take you where he wants to take his people. You and his people. Worthless. Sunday school teacher. Disciple. church member. What's going on? You have become worthless to the kingdom. Woo. What's to happen to me? I think Jesus said it to them, like, you take them out, and you the shaft is, you know what you do with the shaft? Perfect. Never ever open. The stuff that you can't use in the garden. You get those thorns out of there, they stick in you in the garden. What are you going to do? Lay them around for your kids to get a hold of? Burn them. Burn it up. Get rid of it. It's worthless. That's what a life feels. It's not honoring the Lord of the world. Worthless.
But when Saul's issue, Saul didn't have a redemptive heart like that.
No.
Even when Nathan came to him, he didn't.
He was kind of.
He never pride. Repented.
Yeah, right. Full of pride.
Yeah, he never stood up, went to God and said, hey, I'm sorry, I made this mistake.
Yeah. He could thank God.
Right.
He could have repented, got right with God, but he went through his course, and God determined you're worthless. Wait a minute. That sounds like reprobate. So, God turns him over to a can't deal with him. That hurt everybody else leaving around. A couple of cities like that, Sodom and Gomorrah. Worthless. Got to do what? Destroy. Worthless. Hurt somebody else if they come in contact. That's why it says, verse 7 of my lesson, but the man that should touch them, touch those thorns, must be fenced with iron and the shaft of a spear, and they shall be utterly burnt with fire in the same place. You got to stand back with a distance and handle it. Come and get in contact with the same as somebody that just won't clean up their ways. Preachers that just won't clean up their ways. Oh boy. Let's see here. I wish I could come. Come up with some crazy doctrines. Everybody's saved. There's a preacher that was like that on the South Side. Everybody's saved. Unification church. Crazy doctrines. And he says, now, the elders, let's straighten this out. You done went off track somewhere here. Let's get in front of this. Stay with it. Even write a book about it. Everybody's getting saved. Worthless.
Nobody's going to hell.
Nobody's going to hell. That type doctrine and that kind of stuff. Bring that stuff in.
Yes, it's so
thorns. People are getting hurt coming close to you. Mm-hmm. They don't intentionally, they just reach, they got hurt. Okay, so here we're going to summarize it all up. David says, my life in 1 Chronicles 18. Let's go there. David sums it all up. 1 Chronicles 18. I know it's given us some verses there. It's given us verse 14, but let's look at it from the scripture. Mm-hmm. This is what David's reign looked like. Mm-hmm. Verse 6, we'll start there. Then David put garrisons in Assyria, Damascus, and Syrians became David's what? Servants. And brought what?
Gifts.
Uh-oh, starting a wealth building. Thus the Lord preserved David wheresoever he went. Mm-hmm. And David took the shields of gold that were on the servants of Hadarezer. Is that right, Sophia?
Yeah, you're close.
Hadarezer, and brought them to Jerusalem. Okay, David took the shields of what? Gold. Building up some wealth. Likewise from Tabhat and from Shun, cities of Hadarezer, brought David very much brass. Whole lot of brass. What with Solomon made the brazen sea and the pillows and the vessels of brass. Let's go to verse 11. Them also King David dedicated unto the Lord with the silver and the gold that he brought from all these nations, from Edom, Moab, from the children of Ammon, and from the Philistines, and from Amalek. See, all that David gathered up in war, the silver, the gold, the brass, he took it, and this was like, in our terms, money, all of his resources, he took it and dedicated it to the Lord. Mm-hmm. He might have tied off of that. Think about him, you know. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I ain't got time to go into them kind of lessons, but yeah, somebody, this is God's. He saved my life. He gave me strength to go conquer all my enemies. Everything that's contrary against me, negative against me, gave me power over it. I conquered it. I took it all. I got it here. Guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to dedicate it to him. Now, most folks won't do that. When the pimp was out in the world, what did he do when he was making his money?
Pocket it.
Big old rolls of money in his pocket. Big old long Cadillacs. None of that going to the river. Okay, let's go to verse 14. So David reigned over all Israel and executed judgment and justice among all the people. And Joab, the son of Zebulun was over the host. Who's that person? Verse 15. Joab, the son of Zeruiah, he's the captain of David's army. And when we read in Psalms 34 earlier, come ye children, listen to me, I teach you the fear of the Lord, yes, he was there. He was one of those guys. And he's the captain of David's army. You think he's getting some wealth too?
Yeah.
He's getting wealthy too. Praise God. So, and Jehoshaphat, and this is all sums up the summary, and this is what David did. He just got a whole bunch of victories. Sometimes in the course of his life, he would falter, run in trouble with God, or do something sinful and crazy, but he was quick to repent. And he was known by God as the man after my heart, wants to please me so much that sin just eats him up. Now, he's high and mighty, position-wise, very high and mighty. And it's hard to tell a leader who's got it all going on for a subordinate to make a suggestion, bring in a counsel. Okay, most people will say, the leader says, when you get to where I am, then you can tell me what you know, or what the Lord is saying to you. So, a position of that, we got to get out of here. You have to watch out for pride.
Yep.
Because he was in a position, he just take what he wanted. I want another wife. Well, he was. I want that man's wife. Go get her. Bring her up here. That's how it was. So he was just a man that's subject to the temptations that everybody else faces. Oh, boy. All right, now we got to get out of here. Time flies.
It does.